Hello, my name is Sabine O'Hara. I am Dean of the College of Agriculture, Urban Sustainability and Environmental Sciences and Director of Land Grant Programs of the University of the District of Columbia. What is economic development? What makes it happen? What hinders it? What sustains it in the long run? What makes some communities successful with people and businesses moving in, while others lose jobs and see people moving away? Are these questions of interest to you? They have certainly captured my interest for many years now. After all, without economic development, communities are in a tough position. No economic development, no jobs, no money for schools, parks, and streets, no purchasing power, even fewer businesses keeping their doors open, and so goes the downward spiral. But when the economy is doing well and economic development is strong, then the opposite happens. Economic development brings jobs. The businesses that do well order things from other businesses, and now they are doing well too. Also, people who have jobs have money to spend and want to buy things. They also pay taxes and fill the municipality's coffers to fund schools, parks, and other public institutions. And so goes the upward economic development spiral. Many times, a community or region will have one particular sector of the economy that drives this upward spiral of economic development. We call this sector the base sector or base industry. For example, the textile industry was the base sector for communities along our rivers in the eastern United States for decades. Coal was the base sector for Pennsylvania and still is the base of West Virginia. And sometimes it's not a base sector or base industry, but a base company that is the linchpin of a local economy. We call that the one company town. For example, Boeing functioned as the base company for Seattle, Washington, and General Electric for Schenectady, New York. But if the base sector or company does not do well, the whole community is impacted and goes into a downward spiral. This model has driven our economic policies for many decades. It looks something like this. A city will attract a base industry or company by giving tax breaks or offering incentives to entice the base industry to locate in their city, region, or state. The incentives take many forms, like building a training facility or an industrial park. A community may also agree to expand the local airport, improve streets and roads, expand water and sewer lines, or improve recreational areas for the future workforce, all offered to attract the right company. But what is the evidence that this model of economic development actually works? Frankly, there is not much. Several years ago, my graduate students and I reviewed a number of reports from communities that had used this approach to stimulate their local economies. We found no conclusive evidence that the approach worked. We did see evidence that in some cases there was an economic upswing, but for a limited time. But overall, there was no conclusive evidence that the model of economic development that we call the base sector or base industry model actually worked as a long-term strategy for economic development. So, what are some of the pitfalls that would cause this base theory to fail? First, economic development based on a single model can be too much of a good thing. If orders for airplanes are down, then Boeing will lay off workers to cut costs. If turbines are cheaper produced elsewhere in China than in the United States, everybody will order their turbines from China. And if the textile industry moves abroad because labor costs are cheaper there than in the United States, then cities that built their economies on textiles are in trouble. In other words, it may not be a good idea to put all of our economic development eggs in one basket. If there is too much of a presence of one company or one sector in a community or region, then there is no way to balance the downturn in that economic sector, and there is no other sector that can absorb the job losses. Today, a big game changer is that the economy is not just defined by a single community, city, state, or region, or even country. our economy is global. Today, if a city gives tax breaks to a software company so that it will locate in that city, the main job growth, the added money to spend on restaurants, department stores, and other businesses may happen in Mumbai, India, and not here in the United States at all. The reason is that the software company may only keep a very tiny workforce in the city that gave them the tax breaks. They may hire most of their additional workers in India. In other words, the global economy and the technology we now have allows a company to work from almost anywhere in the world. This introduces leakages. The benefits of the incentive package that the base sector or base industry received and that was designed to stimulate a local economy in the United States has leaked out to someone else's economy. And sometimes the leakage goes right across the country, but in the global economy, it can go around the world. But there is an upside to the technology that makes jobs less dependent on a specific location. When jobs are technology dependent, the skilled labor can be located just about anywhere. And when people can link into their job sites via a computer connected to the internet, they can choose to live just about anywhere. This means that a trained workforce can make the decision to where to live not based on the company's location, but based on the quality of life they're looking for. In other words, people drive economies. The needs of people, of workers, their families, retirees, translate into local markets. The businesses follow. Especially businesses that need a highly trained workforce to succeed in the new creative post-industrial economy. Companies will locate where they can find a qualified workforce, and where that workforce chooses to live will drive economic development. So what do people look for when they determine where to live and work? Simply stated, things that make for a good life, an enjoyable quality life. I call the five things that are most influential in determining our quality of life the five pillars of economic development. These five pillars are essential for long-term economic success. They are the essential basis for building a sustainable local economy. They are health, education, social and cultural amenities, the environment, and information and transportation access. Each of these five pillars can be measured by a set of indicators that signal improvement or deterioration, expansion or decline of that particular pillar. For example, health can be measured by life expectancy, by the percentage of the population suffering from diabetes or heart disease, or the number of physicians per 1,000 of the population. But health can also be measured by the miles of bike path or the number of fitness facilities available. The quality of the environment can be measured in air quality or by the water quality of the local river and whether it is swimmable or fishable. Or the environment can be measured by counting the parks, community gardens, and other green spaces, and by measuring the tree canopy of a community. Education can be measured by looking at the percentage of high school graduates or the academic ranking of the local public school system and how public school students perform in national reading, writing, and math tests. But education can also be measured by the number of continuing education opportunities available. Social and cultural amenities can be measured by looking at the number of sit-down restaurants per 1,000 of the population, the number of movie theaters, concert venues, and art festivals, or by a community's civic engagement, measured in the form of voter participation, for example, or the number of active civic organizations. Transportation and information access can be measured by looking at the percentage of people living within a mile of a rail access or bus line, or by Wi-Fi coverage, broadband width, and public access to computing facilities. Not every community will select the same indicators to determine whether the five pillars are moving in the right direction, to strengthen the local economic development potential of a community, or whether they are moving in the wrong direction. Age, gender, ethnicity, and culture all play a role in deciding the most relevant indicators. When my sons still lived at home, the quality of the public schools was an important indicator for us. Environmental quality had a lot to do with our access to a fishable river, and we defined important cultural amenities as having access to live musical performances and soccer games. But now, I measure educational quality more in terms of whether there are interesting lecture series and exhibits. And a strong social and cultural amenity for me means a robust and diverse local food culture. It's okay that not every community tracks the same indicators, and these indicators may change over time too. There is a reason why some people prefer to live in Maine and others in Arizona. In fact, diversity and distinct local character are precisely one of the strong suits of a local economy. But all communities have innate economic development potential, and the need to select indicators that reflect the interests and needs of those who live there today and those who will live there later. This does not mean that standard economic indicators like the number of jobs created or the household income of a community are completely irrelevant. But I look at economic indicators more as outcomes. The indicators that make up the five pillars are more proactive. They measure more what leads to economic development success. The five pillars carry or undergird the local economy. Now, you might think this is pure theory. I challenge you to think again. If the only thing a community does is measure the number of jobs each quarter or each year, then it will do very different things and enact very different policies than if that same community wants to make sure that the jobs created are jobs that stay around, jobs that make people healthy and happy rather than sick or grumpy. If a city wants to create positive kinds of jobs, it will enact policies that lead to a strong education system, strong social and cultural amenities, and a healthy environment. The skilled workforce of the post-industrial economy has options. And if a community does not strengthen the five pillars, they will not stay around. Simply consulting economic standard measures is not enough to drive economic development in a global economy. Developing a community's economic development potential requires using the five pillars as people-driven indicators to help identify the right direction, the right action, and the right policies that result in sustainable economic development. Giving incentives to businesses is only one policy tool. Creating sustainable and thriving economies requires more than one tool. It requires a whole toolbox full of the right tools to get the right results for a given community, city, or state. And a toolbox that has the right tools has the five pillars of economic development: health, education, social and cultural amenities, environmental quality, and information and transportation as indicators to move communities in the right direction. There are over 1,000 communities worldwide that have done quality of life studies. But let's not stop there. Every community and every region should incorporate the five pillars of economic development to get on a sustainable path for successful economic development and a successful future.